I think, I don't know if it is on, but good morning, everybody. So let's start the second day of the worship. And Xerxes is going to talk about Beyond the Standard Model.
We started by talking about aspects of the SUSY model. We saw that if assuming R parity conservation, that the lightest supersymmetric particle would be stable, and it could not be charged or colored because of restrictions from observations of or non-observations of exotic isotopes and atoms. And we ended by saying that the presence of this thing that would escape the detector would result in apparent energy-momentum imbalance in collider events. So if there are any questions on what we said yesterday, we can talk about that. Otherwise, I will move on. So, nothing? Okay. So we also saw that if we parametrize our ignorance of SUSY breaking, there are many parameters. I think I counted 178 yesterday. We didn't count them in detail, but there are. Usually people say 124 because they don't allow these soft terms which are contain a Daggert field. But a lot of parameters anyway. So we need some guidance and models for break. How to do phenomenology, because with 178 parameters, it is too much for any normal human being. So what do? We have to get guidance from phenomenology. Now, one of the things about SUSY theories that we saw was generically, there are many scalars, because all the superpartners of the matter fermions are scalars. And if you have many scalars from lots of experiences before, typically you get unwanted flavor-changing neutral currents, and in a big way. So that's another, you know, sort of thing you can do, anti-propaganda for generic SUSY. You would get lots of flavor-changing neutral currents. So where do these come from? So for example, let's look at the quark-gluino interactions in the flavor bases. So this is the quark in the flavor bases. This is the superpartner of the quark in the flavor bases, the gluino, and there's some matrix that connects them in the flavor space. And of course, in flavor space, this is diagonal by definition in the current basis. But we have to get to the mass basis. So if the mass eigenstates of the quarks are related to the flavor states by a matrix U, and of the quarks in general will be by a different matrix U tilde, the problem is, so then in the mass basis, the gluino interaction takes this form. And the problem is that U tilde U is a non-diagonal matrix. Yeah?
You have 173 parameters, but you are telling me. So do you mean that they are independent parameters, or if you decide some of the parameters from some process, then some of the other parameters can be constrained?
No, so generically, I mean, if we write down a generic supersymmetric theory and say, I know nothing about them, just Lorentz invariance and gauge invariance, then there are these 178 parameters which are independent. To do phenomenology with that would be very hard. Now, if these were independent, I'm arguing here, there would be enormous flavor-changing neutral currents. So we seek guidance. We know these neutral currents are not there. And so we seek guidance saying what sort of restrictions should we put among these parameters, and that's what I'm trying to get at. Okay? How to build a model which will not have this. So what can we get in the flavor space, the problem is this matrix U tilde U is not a diagonal matrix or not a unit matrix. And if this was not a diagonal matrix, then we would get things like B to S gamma at an enormous rate. So what can we do? One stupid solution is to say all superpartners are extremely heavy. Then since there are heavy particles running in the loop, their effects will be suppressed by the mass. It depends on which process you are looking at. So they can be in the TeV range, or for some processes really heavy, tens of TeV, if you look at something like KK bar. So that's one possibility. The second possibility is to make the superpartners with the same gauge quantum numbers degenerate. So then, if they were degenerate, in the flavor space they would have a unit matrix. And then when you rotate a unit matrix, of course it remains a unit matrix. Okay? So that's the second type of solution. The third type of solution, and we'll see there are models which realize this, is to make this identity either dynamically, or you just say, I'm going to make it identity. This went under the name of alignment. I won't talk about alignment in this. So that was one problem, the flavor problem. The second thing is, in the early 80s, when people started building these models, the first thing that... No. So if the violation is only by CKM, then it is under control. It's not crazy.
But you will have flavor change in metal cards, but...
But they will not be... Yeah. Yeah. So I'm talking about new sources. Yeah. Okay. So in the 80s, when we first started building models of SUSY, people were considering SUSY as a global symmetry. Not a local symmetry, not supergravity. In that case, we got this sum rule that the spin-weighted mass squares of the bosonic guys was the spin-weighted mass squares for the fermionic guys. This was quite generic for global SUSY models and in each charge sector. So for example, if I was considering something, down quark sector, so charge minus one-third sector, it said that the mass squares of the bosons weighted by 2j plus 1 was the mass squares of all the down type quarks with the same weight. And that, of course, meant, so this average was that the, on an average, the boson masses and the fermion masses were the same, except for these weights, which meant, and we know the masses of the fermions, the heaviest guy is the B quark, the down type fermions. Quarks. And so one of the bosons, so the bosons were spread about the B quarks. So one of the B's quarks had to be extremely light. And that, of course, is an obvious problem, lighter than the bottom quark. And that was not seen, so that is not so good. So we had to get around this sum rules. I'm not going to discuss models in details, but there were two broad ways of getting around. One was that these were global SUSY sum rules. If you make SUSY local, it turns out that you got an extra term which involved the gravitino mass which could uplift the sector of the bosons. Okay, so the sum rule had something proportional to the gravitino mass on the other side. So these guys got lifted to the scale of the gravitino mass. So one loophole was this local SUSY. The second thing, the second way of doing this thing, which was also used in models, I emphasize that these were tree-level sum rules. So you arrange for models where all the masses, these guys, arise only at the loop level. Then the sum rules don't work, and models which were based on this, for example, what are called gauge-mediated SUSY models. So you could get around these sum rules in that way. And in these models, or anomaly-mediated SUSY breaking, we won't talk about what that means, maybe very briefly later, the scalars with the same quantum numbers automatically got the same mass, because the masses were determined by the gauge interaction. So if your gauge quantum numbers were the same, they got the same mass. So the flavor problem was also advertised to be solved. I think there was another technical assumption needed, which is not usually talked about, but we won't go into that here. This flavor problem is not naturally solved in supergravity models. You have to do something technical and new, and there is something called the Kähler potential, and you made technical assumptions on the Kähler potential and that to arrange for that. And that's the reason for the M in Sugra. But going along this line of flavor, you could make an extreme ansatz. Forget about masses of particles with the same quantum numbers being the same. Make an extreme ansatz, which I call universality. Just say all scalars had a common mass M0. And we talked about the trilinear soft coupling. Assume that was universal. Assume the Gaugino masses are universal. And of course, we had the Higgsino mass parameter mu. So this was a very simple model. I mean, it's not a model. I mean, it's a simple ansatz with just five parameters, which respects flavor. And in fact, this ansatz is realized in the so-called minimal supergravity model, which people worked on as a sort of baseline model for decades. And the gut assumption, grand unification, assumes that just as there is only one coupling and the three gauge couplings arise from renormalization, it assumes there was one common Gaugino mass and the renormalization effects caused the mass of the gluino to be different from the mass of the vino and the bino. Okay, just as. And then, if you assume that, then the running of the Gaugino mass parameters and alphas are similar, and you get this relationship at the weak scale. And this, since alpha 3 is way larger than alpha 1, the U1 gauge coupling, M3 will be correspondingly larger than the same. So colored particles are heavy. Now, this one objection you would make if I use a universal M0 is that we need squared Higgs masses to be negative, but of course the matter scalars better not get a negative mass. I think people realize that what you should think about what I said, this universal parametrization, this ansatz, is this is an ansatz which holds for the Lagrangian parameters renormalized at some very high scale, usually taken to be near M-gut or M-Planck, where this model is realized, and then you have to renormalize the parameters down, including the mass parameters, because these were Lagrangian parameters and they do depend on the scale. So you evolve this using renormalization group techniques, just the same way in a gut you evolve the gauge couplings down and you get G3, G2 and G1 different from each other. Now, in the revolution, one thing you must know, I'll tell you just as facts of life, is gauge couplings increase. So at some high scale I have a universal mass M0. Gauge couplings, as we come down to the weak scale, gauge couplings increase the masses. Yukawa couplings decrease the masses. So there's a competition. The final mass that you get will be a combination of the renormalization due to the gauge couplings and the Yukawa couplings. And these are in opposite directions. So if the Yukawa couplings are negligible, say for example, for the first generation fermions, the Yukawa couplings are negligible. Then since gauge couplings of squarks are larger than the gauge couplings of the leptons, squarks will generically be heavier than the leptons. And since the left-handed squarks will be heavier than the sleptons. The left-handed sleptons have SU2 couplings, which are larger than the hypercharged gauge coupling. So left-handed squarks will be heavier than right-handed squarks, simply because G2 is bigger than G1. That's this effect that I told you. Now let's turn to the effect of the Yukawa couplings. The biggest Yukawa coupling is in the top sector. Now Yukawa couplings decreases the masses. So the top left gets corrections due to the top Yukawa coupling, so it can make a bubble of, it can go into top right or top right and the Higgs or the Higgsino. So there is a top right running in the loop and become a top left again. That's a renormalization of the stop left mass. So what runs in the loop is the top right for the effect on the stop left mass. But stop right is a singlet, or top right is a singlet. So let's say that loop gives one unit of effect. On the other hand, the stop right mass has the left-handed stops and bottoms running in. That's a doublet. So the renormalization due to the Yukawa coupling will be twice as big for the stop right as for the stop left. And since the Yukawa coupling reduces the mass, generically stop right will be lower in mass than the stop left. Its strong interactions will increase the mass, the Yukawa couplings reduce the mass. The Yukawa couplings also have an effect on the Higgses, because Higgs couples to the stops. What runs in the Higgs loops are the top stop or stops or tops. But these are colored. So there are three guys running in that loop. So the effect on the Higgs is even more than the effect on the stop rights. In these, it is 3 units compared to 2 units here and 1 unit there. So the Higgs mass is reduced maximally. And the Higgs mass doesn't rise very much due to gauge interactions because it has no colored interactions. So the Higgs actually can turn around and become negative even though they all started the same. And when this was realized in the mid-80s, everybody was very happy, and this became known as the celebrated radiative electroweak symmetry breaking. So that's what I've tried to show here. All the scalars start at a common mass here. The quarks run up maximally, the first generation quarks. The leptons run less, so they are lighter at the weak scale, and the stops run to below the Higgs masses, whereas the Higgs actually can turn and become negative due to these renormalization group effects, and electroweak symmetry is broken. Okay? So this was one of the big deals in the mid-80s. And so many of the models that we discuss incorporate this. So I'm not going to discuss models in detail, but basically tell you that models are characterized by, so there, typically in a model there is a Susie breaking sector and there is the standard model sector. These must interact somehow. If they didn't interact, even if Susie were broken here, our particles would not feel it, the superpartners. One interaction we know must exist is gravity. So they at least interact via gravity. But in gauge-mediated models, there may be other interactions, like gauge interactions, which connect the two. But gravity is always there. Okay? So, if gravity is the dominant mechanism for mediating the interaction between the Susie breaking sector and the observable sector, those are supergravity models. If gauge interactions were the dominant way of mediating the interactions, they will be the so-called gauge-mediated Susie breaking models, and so on. Okay, so the mediator is important. And I think we had already seen that the minimal supergravity model, I had just mentioned without saying it, and again I'm going to say it, it's the same universal ansatz that we made that characterize it. Later, this had a universal mass for all scalars. In the last 20 years, 15 years or so, we have realized it is better to consider models where the matter scalars have a common mass, but the Higgs scalars' masses may be independent of the matter scalar masses. These go under the name of non-universal Higgs mass models. They'll be important later, so keep that in mind. The gauge-mediated models, I'm not going to talk about very much. There is something called anomaly mediation. Again, these are both gauge mediation and anomaly mediation have masses at the loop level. And there are other variations, some of which are quite interesting. One of them is a combination of anomaly engage mediation. But again, this is not the place to discuss this, but they do have interesting phenomenology. And for those of you who are interested, they often go under the name of Mirage Mediation for reasons I can't go into here. So if there are any questions on this stuff, otherwise I'm going to use what we said to try to discuss collider signatures. Okay, so let's turn to collider signatures. Before we turn to collider signatures, we need to know how superpartners would be produced and how they decay. Then we combine those two and we'll get what a supersymmetric event would look like. So, at a hadron collider, it's a complicated business because we collide protons. The partons which contain the partons in the proton, the quarks and the gluons, the guys that participate in the hard collision, in this case to produce a gluino and a quark and a gluon may make a quark and a gluino. That is what is described by the Lagrangian of Susi that we had, the MSSM Lagrangian, the hard process. The quarks and the gluinos then decay by cascade decays. That is also described by our Lagrangian, and we're going to talk about the decay pattern shortly. But there are things which are not described by our Lagrangian, but are described by the standard model Lagrangian, and that is radiation of the initial state partons, because a lot in a hard process there can be a lot of QCD radiation, and then ultimately the final state quarks and gluons have to turn to hadrons, so that has to be modeled. And then these partons took part in the hard collision, but the rest of the partons go down the beam pipe and there are remnants in the beam, which again need some modeling. These are not part of our SUSY theory. That's part of the standard model, or nobody knows, I mean, phenomenological models. Okay, so we have to do all this, but our interest is just the production and the decays. That's the new part, the new physics part. So we said that superpartners would be pair-produced, and the pair production occurs mainly by gauge interactions. And if we know all the gauge interactions of superpartners, because we know that the superpartners have the same gauge quantum numbers as ordinary particles. That's what makes this thing somewhat predictive. And at a hadron collider, like the LHC, quarks and gluinos will be the most produced superpartners, most copiously produced, if they are within the kinematic range. But in most models that we know of, the colored particles tend to be heavier than the uncolored particles because of the renormalization group effects that I talked about. It doesn't have to be, but in many models that is the case. So even though the dynamics tends to favor them, kinematics, the production, the kinematics goes in the opposite direction. And it can happen that if quarks and gluinos are very heavy, then electroweak production of charginos and neutralinos, because they are lighter than the gluinos, may be the dominant mechanism. So I don't know how much to go through in detail, because this can become extremely boring. So I'll just take you very quickly through the production mechanisms, not worrying about the Feynman diagrams, which I have shown you here for gluino and quark production processes. Notice that all the vertices are essentially strong interaction vertices. So everything is determined by the QCD coupling, GS, which of course we know. And so if we knew the mass of the quark and mass of the gluino, since we know the QCD coupling, these cross sections are known in a model independent way, because there are no mixings, except perhaps for the top quarks. Okay? And since most of the partons are in the proton, the most abundant partons are the first generation quarks and first generation leptons, the mixings don't matter. So these cross sections are completely fixed by QCD in all models, just in terms of the mass of the quark and mass of the gluino. So there's no model dependence. For the charginos and neutralinos, there is model dependence.
What would be the argument to make gluino heavier than chargino?
No, so that's the assumption, that if you had a common M1/2, the common Gugino mass at some high scale, and you got it by renormalization, then gluinos were heavier. Because I showed you that relation, right? M3 over alpha 3. M3 over alpha 3 was M2 over alpha 2 was M1 over alpha 1. And since we know alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, that makes the gluino heavier. If there are models where that is violated, but I'm not talking about that. Okay. So, for example, the neutralino mass matrix has this part from the two higgsinos that we had, and this part from the bino and the vino. And after SU2 cross breaking, SU2 cross U1 breaking, we have mixings between the gegenos and the higgsinos. So if there was no mixing, then the mass eigenstates would be a bino with mass M1, a vino with mass M2, and higgsinos with mass mu, two higgsinos with mass mu. And mixings will alter these patterns. If the mixings, if M1 and M2 or mu are much larger than this, then we know that the mixings don't matter. I mean, like if M1 and M2 was very large, then we do have these guys as mass eigenstates, and then the other guys are essentially the mu's, right? So that's what I have written here. If M1 and M2 are very large, then the heaviest eigenstates are the bino and the vino, and the lightest eigenstates are the higgsinos, okay? And but the opposite in the case of mu being much larger than M2. Okay, so these mixings do matter, but if the mixings are unimportant, then this thing becomes predictive. Otherwise, Giorgino neutralino production mostly occurs again by gauge interactions, but modulo the mixings will be model independent. So there will be some model dependence on the cross section coming from these mixing angles. Okay? And so, but there are electro weak production mechanisms for producing Giorginos and Higgsinos. That's the message. Compared to strong productions for gluinos and squarks. Slepton production, skip. So, let's look at what production rates based on what I said would look like. So again, I'm assuming Gugino mass unification in this plot. And there are two frames on this plot. This is for the LHC at 14 TeV. This assumes that squark and gluino masses are comparable. Here, squark mass is much heavier than the gluino mass in the bottom frame. What you see is the solid line is the strong production. So this, because squarks and gluino masses are comparable, gluino pairs, squark pairs, and gluino squarks are all produced at comparable rates. And the total rate is dominated by the strong production. Until these guys get very heavy, and then the electroweak production, because the enos are lighter, starts to win. If squarks are very heavy, they cannot be produced, and then mostly only this, even though I've written all three, mostly this is gluino pairs. And then the crossover between the gluino production and the eno production occurs at a gluino mass of around a TeV. I'm sorry. Okay, so for very heavy squarks, eno production wins if we assume Gugino mass unification and if gluinos are heavier than a TeV. Now LHC, most of this plot is excluded today because LHC guys have told us, we'll see in the next, tomorrow's lecture in more detail, that the gluino mass bound is somewhere, depending on its decay modes, between 1.5 and 2 TeV. Okay? So most of this plot is outdated. So let me give you a different version of this plot, production rate plot, with a different ansatz. In the previous plot, which was based on this universality ansatz, mu is typically very heavy. In these plots, we have taken mu to be roughly M gluino. So mu is much heavier than the Gugino, electroweak Gugino masses in this plot. So Higgsino production is very suppressed. This plot, which I have said is a plot for natural SUSY, which I haven't explained to you what natural SUSY is, and we'll come to that tomorrow. But one of the conditions we will see tomorrow is that mu has to be small, comparable to the weak scale. So in this plot, I've taken mu to be 150 GeV and done a plot versus M1/2. To calibrate this, you should remember that Mgluino is about 2.5 times M1/2. Okay, so think of this as a Gluino plot and multiply all the numbers in your head by 2.5. And we know that the Gluino mass bound, say 1.5 TeV, is somewhere here. So the left of, say, about 600, let's say, is excluded. Okay? We'll see that in more detail tomorrow. Then the biggest cross-section here is for production of hexenos. And it's an enormous cross-section. It's a picobarn. And you should be able to. So we are producing a lot of, if this were correct, we would be producing a lot of hexenos at the LHC. But the hexenos, I told you there is a pair of hexenos, and there is a charged hexeno, all of them have mass which is roughly mu. Even the heavier hexenos, all the masses are mu plus minus something small. In that case, when the hexenos decay, there is very little energy release in the decay, visible energy release, because the heavier hexenos will decay into the lightest supersymmetric particle plus ordinary particles, but the lightest supersymmetric particle and the parent hexeno have roughly the same mass. So the energy, visible energy release is extremely small. So you won't see, even though there is a big cross-section, it'll be hard to pull this out at the LHC. You will never see it from these pair production processes. Is the point clear? That most of the energy gets dumped into the LSPs, which are not moving very fast, so there is, you see nothing. Just some piddly small jets or very soft leptons, which cannot make any signature. So your best hope then is to look at these events. These are Vino production events, which win over the Gluino production, as I told you. We'll again come back to this next time. So the point I'm making is hexeno production events are very hard to see. They are the biggest cross-section. And Vino pair production, whether it's a production of Vino plus, Vino minus, or a Vino plus minus and a neutral Vino, right? It's the analog of WZ. So these events, the cross-section dominates. And squarks have been assumed to be heavy and have unobservable cross-sections. So again, I'm emphasizing electroweak production is the dominant process for given what we know today, but we'll come back to this. How do superpartners decay? Well, if squarks are heavy, they will dominantly decay into a quark and a lighter Gluino, if that decay is allowed, and that decay goes by the strong interaction, so it will dominate. If this decay is not allowed, then they will decay into the chargenos and the neutralinos by the electroweak gauge interactions. Of course, if squarks are too heavy to be produced, you wouldn't care about that. But if they are produced, this is how they will decay. So depending on whether squarks are heavier or lighter than the Gluino. The Gluinos only have strong interactions, so they can only decay into quark-squark. But if this is forbidden, this quark will be virtual, and then this virtual quark will decay in this manner. So Gluinos will decay into QQ bar and a neutralino, or a QQ bar and a chargino. And tops are special. Oh, Gluino goes to... I meant to write top stops, and the stop may be virtual. This may be the most important decay if stops happen to be significantly lighter than the other quarks. So this should be top, stop. And the star means the stop might be virtual. Okay? If this is not the case, and if quarks are decaying like this, or gluinos are decaying like this, they will prefer to go into the decay with the highest gauge coupling. The highest gauge coupling is the SU2 coupling. It's higher than the hypercharge coupling. So they will prefer to go into Vinos rather than into B nodes. So the decay will occur by a multi-step process, that the gluino decays into a vino, and then the vino further decays down to the LSP. These are called cascade decays. And this is quite generic. It's just because of the SU2 content, SU2 cross U1 invariance, that the SU2 coupling is bigger than the U1 coupling. Sleptons I'm not going to care about here. Squarks, do I need to talk about this? Yeah, I don't think we need to talk about this. So this I think I've already told you. Okay, so let's come to Chargino and neutralino decays. Chargino's, heavy Chargino's will decay into lighter neutralinos and a W, or into a Z and a charged Higgs, if this were allowed. Often this is not allowed, and so this decay tends to dominate. Okay? If this decay is not kinematically possible for any neutralino, then the W will be virtual, and W will, of course, decay into the ordinary fermions. So if W mediates, often in models, W mediates the Chargino decay, either a real or an off-shell W. So the branching ratios for Chargino decays are often the same as the branching ratios for W's, which we know. So one-ninth of the time, the W decays into a E, nu, mu, and a tau, and the same thing for the Chargino, except that there is an extra neutralino along with it. And so I think that's... Neutralino decays are often more complex because you might think analogously that the neutralino would decay by a virtual Z. But the problem with that is that the neutralino, just as there is no Z neutral gauge boson, neutral gauge boson coupling, there is no, by supersymmetry, there is no Z neutral gaugeino vertex. That is forbidden by SU2. So neutralinos can only decay via Z only couples to the Higgsinos. Okay, Z doesn't couple to a gaugeino pair, neutral gaugeino pair. SU2 forbids that. And so this depends on these model dependent mixings, and so there is more model dependence in neutralino decays. Even though the Z might be much lighter, it may or may not dominate. If sleptons and squarks are really heavy, then the Z does dominate, and the branching ratios are the branching ratios of Z. But generically, this is not true. Whereas for Chargino's, the branching ratios of the Chargino's are very close to the branching ratios of W's. So I know all this is very boring or familiar. I'm sorry if I'm repeating things you know. But this basically summarizes everything that we have said. I guess I don't need to say it again. So unless there are any questions on this, I will move on. Yeah. Which one? Yeah. Okay, sure. Yeah, sorry.
Or if
yeah.
you like, you can say it again.
Okay, I'll say it again. So it's boring for me to say it again also. Okay, so squarks will decay into quark and a gluino if the decay is allowed. If not, they will decay into charginos and neutralinos. The left squark, because it is an SU2 doublet, can decay into charginos. It has a... because this is an SU2 doublet. The right squark is always an SU2 singlet, so it cannot have any coupling to vinos. So it typically decays only to neutralinos because the Higgsino coupling is tiny. Okay? So the squark left decays into the eno with the highest SU2 gauge eno content. That's dynamically preferred because G2 is bigger than G1. Okay. Heavy stops decay more democratically because the Yukawa couplings are important, and this dynamic favoring by the gauge coupling is not important. Gluinos decay via quarks, where this is real or virtual, and the squark decays exactly as I said above, so gluinos decays via this, and with favoring the highest SU2 content, unless the stop is very light. In that case, gluinos will decay via the stops, and then it's more democratic. Okay, for squarks and gluinos. Venus, for practical purposes, decay via W, real or virtual. That's the bottom line. So the branching, if these decays are forbidden, which they often are in models because these guys are too heavy, then they decay via W. And if it's a virtual decay, which it often is for the lighter Veno, then the branching ratio will be exactly W branching ratios. The neutral Eno branching ratios are more model dependent, and there are a whole bunch of possibilities. Okay? So the main point is that heavy quarks do not directly decay to the LSP. They go via this cascade chain because dynamics favors either decays to top stops or to, what do you call it? The hypercharge gauge coupling being smaller. So cascade decays are the rule rather than the exception. Okay? So, what are the typical lifetimes? If, just a rough estimate, if the decays are two-body decays, then they are one gauge coupling constant in the amplitude, or in the rate, the square of a gauge coupling constant times the mass, divided some few pi squares or something. So typically, it's alpha over something, 10 or 100 times the mass. For a three-body decay, it's alpha squared because it's a higher order with the mass of the thing in between times mass to the fifth for dimensional reasons. This is from the propagator. I mean, this is just very generic. And if you plug in numbers and choose alpha to be something like 1 over 100 or some number like that, some typical gauge coupling, you find that the rates are two-body decays, the lifetimes are 10 to the minus 23 seconds, and for three-body decays, 10 to the minus 18 seconds. The number is not exactly important. What is important is this exponent. The bottom line is the superpartners decay promptly. You're not going to see a gap, a vertex displaced in the detector, typically. People use event generator programs. You can't see this, so I won't pretend to tell you all this. This is some typical Gluino decay chain, and just based on what we said, all possible things. And if you look at it more carefully, there are about 1,000 decays, 1,000 possibilities or so, just for one single Gluino. So if you produce a Gluino on one side with 1,000 possibilities, on the other side, something else is going by 1,000 possibilities, you get a huge proliferation of possibilities. And that's why people use event generator programs rather than a head. Heads get full. There is another possibility which is disfavored now, and that is that the Gravitino is the LSP. This was when people were studying gauge-mediated SUSY braking, this was definitely a characteristic of that model. And it makes no, if the Gravitino was very light, but if the Gravitino happens to be an LSP and has a mass of the order of the weak scale, because then the decays will proceed exactly as we said before, and then what we had called as the lightest neutralino will decay into a Gravitino via gravitational interactions. And so that lifetime is so long that the neutralino will have escaped our detector, and the collider experimentalist would not know that it is going to decay, but it won't matter because it didn't deposit any energy in the detector, and everything would be the same. Okay? This is not favored by other considerations, which I won't go into. There is a possibility that if the Gravitino were the LSP, the next lightest particle need not be the neutralino, because then the cosmological constraints that we talked about may not apply. But so it may be a charge guy, and so there will be extra tracks of this heavy particle. Say, suppose it were a chargino, it would move in the detector, make a track, and leave. But it would be an ionizing track of a slow-moving particle. It would show up in these searches. But I'm not going to talk about that. Super light gravitinos, gravitinos in the EV range or sub-EV range, can make a big difference. And these occur in gauge-mediated Suzy braking models. So, again, I won't go into why they occur, but just take it. But why does that make a difference? Why do you care if a gravitino is very light? So imagine a superpartner, P tilde, was decaying into an ordinary particle in a gravitino. The gravity couples to energy. So its dimensionless coupling, it is suppressed by M Planck, but has to be of order energy over M Planck. And if you plug in numbers pretending that this is the dimensionless coupling, then the longitude, the E over M Planck is the dimensionless coupling. The other thing to remember is that the gravitino, just as a W, after the Higgs mechanism, has a longitudinal component whose couplings are enhanced by E over MW. Same way, the production of a longitudinal, not decoupling, the polarization vector is of enhanced by E over MW. Same way, the polarization vector of the longitudinal gravitino is enhanced by E over M gravitino. And so the effective dimensionless coupling is this. So if M Planck times M gravitino, if this guy is very light even though this guy is very big, happens to be of order E square, then this is substantial. And if you plug in numbers for, say, 100 GeV superpartner, some typical energy, then you find that the lifetime of 100 GeV superpartner decaying into a gravitino is around 10 to the minus 12 seconds times the gravitino mass in EV units. And 10 to the minus 12 seconds gets to be interesting in a collider detector. So that's why these guys are different. But again, we are not going to be bothered by this. So, searching for Suzy, there'll be indirect searches. We can do precision measurements, which rely on loop effects. So for example, the magnetic moment of the muon gets a correction. It was novel when we learned, we saw the correction due to the W, the electroweak correction to the magnetic moment of the muon. But if other superpartners have similar masses as the W, or they're heavier than the W, but if they were not much heavier, then we might hope to see their corrections in there. Flavor violation, as I said, generically is huge, but we have to somehow make models to suppress it. Otherwise, we are dead from the get-go. And so I would say that the Suzy contribution depends really exquisitely, sensitively on how you suppress it. So these tests are good to do, but they are not generic. They are tests of models. At this meeting, I mean, the main interest is things coming up from the sky, the relic density of dark matter has been measured, I think, to better than I wrote, I should correct this. And that is certainly a stringent constraint on any model with a stable, neutral, weakly interacting particle. So this is not only Suzy. Also, much of what I have said is not only Suzy, but also for these other models which contain a stable particle, right? I mean, we talked about the Kaluza-Klein parity or the T parity. So these things are generic to many models, and I've been using Suzy as an example. To my mind, insisting that one particle should saturate the relic density is overkill. Even if thermal production happens, dark matter could be multi-component. We won't go into that. Okay, so indirect detection is dark matter plus dark matter gives us visible stuff, as we heard yesterday. Direct detection is dark matter comes in, collides with the nucleus, and you measure the nuclear recoil. Again, we heard that yesterday, and I'm sure we'll hear more. And there are many future and interesting detectors running that come. But that's not the subject of what I want to say. So at colliders, the electron-positron colliders have done, LEP and LEP2. The production is via gauge interactions. It's pretty democratic for all electric particles. How much time do I have?
10 minutes,
okay. So it's pretty democratic for particles that have electroweak charges, aside from spin and color factors. So they are all produced. A gluino doesn't have electroweak charges, so a gluino cannot be produced. But everything else is produced at comparable rates. And LEP has not seen any signatures. These events would have been very clean. And if there were charged super partners, they would be produced by the photon. We know the exact coupling. We know even the couplings to the Z. So we know the production very well. And the fact that we haven't seen anything puts very stringent limits very close to the beam energy, just below the beam energy. And these limits are fairly modeled. You have to stand on your head to get around these limits. So I would say these limits are very robust. Neutral linear limits in the MSSM have been put, but they are sort of indirect. And they are model dependent. So neutral linear limits you should be more careful about, which come directly. Because essentially, as I said, the Z coupling to the neutralino can be made to vanish even if the neutralino were very light. The line shape limits, of course, work. At hadron colliders, as I said, gluinos and squarks will be the most produced particles, but they may not be accessible. And gluino production is generically leads to cascade decays, and as a result of these cascade decays, more jets or leptons are produced from these guys. So a typical collider event will have many hard jets and missing ET, and very likely or often with leptons from the decays of the chargino or neutralino. The reason I'm emphasizing leptons is leptons are very easy to, I mean, they're much cleaner at the LHC. Okay, lepton, like an E or a mu, which is separated from the jets, an isolated lepton, is much easier to see. It's moving very fast, and in the standard model, leptons are also produced, but the rate is suppressed compared to just producing jets. So, so multi-lepton plus missing ET events are sort of generic at the LHC. Very interesting class of events is when both the guys happen, say one, you produce a gluino pair and it goes to QQ bar chargino plus, the other guy also goes into QQ bar chargino plus. That's possible because the gluino can go to chargino plus or minus 50-50. Right, since it's neutral. So you can get plus plus events or minus minus events at a rate comparable with plus minus events. And then if both charginos decay leptonically, the leptons have the same sign, if they're both positive or both negative. These are called same sign dileptron events, and these are very rare in the standard model. So the standard model backgrounds to same sign dileptron events with missing energy and jets is very small. So that's why it's a big deal, if you can be sure that these leptons have the same sign. Also, if this guy decays into a lepton and this guy decays into a lepton pair, we can get trileptron events. These again are relatively rare in association with jets and missing ET. These are relatively rare in the standard model. So you might ask, but all these cascade decays, they were model dependent. And yeah, it is model dependent. But what is model dependent is what fraction goes into this channel versus what fraction goes into that channel. But if you add up all the things and look inclusively, that rate was fixed by the gluino production rate. So the inclusive rate is roughly not very sensitive to the details of the model. So to see that there is some new physics is roughly speaking independent of the details of the model, then the distribution of the various signals will be model dependent, so we can get information. Having discovered new physics, we have a hope of using these different channels to get information about the underlying model. Okay? Yeah, well, that's just what I said here. So A while back, I don't know, I forget which year it was, 2003, we wrote a paper just basically talking about what the signals in this so-called model with universality would look like. So what you see is the biggest reach, so this is in the M0, M1 half plane of the supergravity model, and what you see is the biggest reach is in the missing ET events with 0 or 1 leptons. But there are many other signals, same sign dileptron, 2 leptons of opposite signs, trileptons, etc. Below these various curves, you would see a signal. Today, we know that the gluino mass is excluded somewhere around here. So we have to be above this line. When we made this curve, this was not there. And this was with just 100 inverse femtobarns. And 100 inverse femtobarns we'll probably get by the end of, sometime during next year. By the end of next year, we should get about 150 inverse femtobarns at the LHC. If you look into the very far future, so gluino signals are dominating here with 100 inverse femtobarns. If you look in the very far future, there is a plan to have what are called the high luminosity LHC, where the claim is that you will get 3,000 inverse femtobarns. For such high luminosities, the best way to look for them, the biggest rate is given by this purple curve, which you see is actually from electroweak production. This is a channel with where the signal is a W, decaying leptonically actually, and a Higgs, decaying into BB bar, making a mass bump, plus missing energy. That signal gives you the biggest reach if squarks are heavy, and it beats the gluino signals. Yeah. Yeah.
You have it for a bit. I'm not sure I understand why the model dependence of the relative amount of each of those signals.
Uh-huh.
For example, you see something that's the same sign dileptron, but you don't see something that's on the.
No, so this was in a particular model. This was in the M-Sugra model, right?
Okay.
So what I'm saying is, in the M-Sugra model, you will get, well, in most models, this 0 lepton and 1 lepton will dominate, okay? And that's only because the branching ratios of the enos are, you know, of the order of a tenth or whatever, W and Z branching.
Seeing something with the same sign and not seeing the other says something about
the
supra.
No, it actually, I think I would bet that you would, same sign, you would, if you saw same sign and if you didn't see the other, I would say it's probably not Susie. I would say that.
Not Susie at all, not just...
Probably not. I haven't thought this through, but we can talk privately, but I would say...
Okay.
I've never seen this happen.
Just some of the 10 beta... And
not important. Not important. Not important. We can... Yeah. In this case, mu positive or negative, again, doesn't make a difference. I've taken mu positive here because if...
Most people believe it's positive. Now, right?
That's only because of the G minus 2.
G minus 2, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
so, yeah. G minus 2, well, okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. But the point I want to make is not that, but the point I want to make is at a high luminosity LHC, it's not the strong production which is going to give you the biggest reach, it's the electroweak production, assuming Gaugino mass unification. We'll come back to this later. Now, some cautions and caveats on this. The Susie spectrum may be compressed from what we have taken it to be here. What I mean by that is all the Susie particles, say, and the LSP, they're all in a narrow range. In that case, the Q value, the energy released, visible energy in the decays, will be very small, and the signals will be reduced. So the efficiencies will be affected. R parity may not be conserved. You may get a softer missing ET spectrum, and the reach may go up or down because the missing energy is changed. Reach may go up because you may get a shit pile of leptons if R parity violation occurs via lepton number violation. We assume prompt decays. There are possibilities of new handles on the signal. which we haven't taken into account, which may actually increase the reach, and so on. So there are a number of caveats in this. Maybe this is, a good point to stop. Tomorrow we'll begin with what we have learned from the LHC. We have learned quite a lot, and it has at least changed some of our thinking, but unfortunately the community is thinking in many different directions, from some people who had been advocating SUSY very strongly turning around and saying, oh, SUSY is now out of the, SUSY is not a good theory anymore because of LHC results. Others saying, no, that's not true. So this will take us into more semi-controversial things, but we will talk about that tomorrow. So I'll tell you the LHC data and then what the issues are and a personal perspective on this. So maybe I should stop here.
We have time for questions. Jens.
So what are the limits for the compressed spectrum? Where how low can they be?
So it'll be very detailed. So it depends on how much you compress it, right? So for example, right. The Higginos that I showed you, they had a cross-section of a pico barn, but you will not see anything, even if the Higgino is 150 GeV, because the compression is just naturally so big, automatically so big, you will never see them in a, by the direct processes that I talked about.
So then one would have to go to precision measurements.
Sorry?
If it's that low, one would have to go to precision
measurements. No, so there are other tricks we can use, which we'll come to tomorrow, of actually for the Higginos. And Higginos is something that has become recently dear to my heart, so I'm going to talk about that. So tomorrow will be more personal perspective than, so far I've tried to be honest.
Yeah. More questions?
But my question very, very simple. Uh-huh. So you say that you have supersymmetric particles, the light supersymmetric particle, and the standard model particle. So we have a probability that this light supersymmetric particle that is to be supposed a candidate to dark matter have a probability to annihilate or decay or interact in general with standard model particle. Yes?
No. The what do you mean by the second statement?
Okay, my question is the lightest supersymmetric particle is a candidate for dark matter, right?
Yeah.
So it is just one. I mean, in this model, you have...
In this model, there is only one.
Okay.
But as I said yesterday, it doesn't mean that dark matter... This may not be all the dark matter. Dark matter may be this guy plus Pierre's axion plus something else. It is logically possible.
Okay.
So this may form only a part of the dark matter. It may be a subdominant part or...
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
More questions? If not, then let's thank our speaker again.
Please.
Thank you. Our next speaker, Jesus, will talk about perspectives on the astrophysics of dark matter. And I have two announcements. One is after the during the coffee break after Jesus' talk, there will be a picture for all the participants in the workshop, just here outside of the auditorium. And Jesus will, there's also a change in the program. We just switched two talks. Jesus will give two talks consecutive, just after the coffee. He will give his final third talk. And then we moved the Axion Dark Matter talk at after lunch. So that's the only, that's the change. So that you're aware of that. I think that those are all the announcements, right?
Gracias. Okay, so I will try to continue where I left yesterday. So for this lecture, I want to now move on to, well, let me first summarize what I said yesterday. So what I tried to do was to give an idea of what is the standard model for structure formation, and that included giving a description of what are the hypotheses that go behind this this theory of structure formation theory. And that one is, of course, the cold dark matter hypothesis. And I just want to emphasize again that in this hypothesis, the main point for galaxy formation and also for dark matter searches is that essentially dark matter gravity is the only relevant interaction. So if you care about the dark matter nature within this model, basically you would take the result from structure formation theory that comes with an ingredient with the only ingredient being the dark matter gravity, and then from that you would extract signals, for example, for dark matter indirect detection experiments or direct detection experiments. And in this sense, for structure formation theory, CDM has no free parameters in the sense of dark matter physics, because all there is dark matter gravity. And, well, I just try to say that, of course, the initial conditions are basically given by the CMB and other observables. The linear regime is very well understood. So those initial conditions are very well understood. And n-body simulations are a very powerful approach to follow this nonlinear evolution. And that's also something that is basically very well established at the scales that matter for galaxy formation. So finally, I mentioned a few things about how the physics of gas and stars can actually change quite a bit the dark matter distribution, so it's something that needs to be taken into account. So for this lecture, I will talk about the possibility of actually non-gravitational dark matter interactions having an impact on structure formation. So let me start with this statement, just simply by saying that, of course, CDM or any structure formation theory in general is going to be incomplete if it doesn't go together with a particle physics model, because, of course, it doesn't tell you anything about what is the nature of dark matter. And that's an unknown. And this question in particular, if really gravity is the only dark matter interaction that matters, is unsolved still. And that's why I think it's important to consider to extend the model. So also want to say that there's really no strong, indisputable evidence that there is something wrong with the CDM model. But I will give some indications that that can probably motivate the need to consider alternatives. And this is what I will do in this lecture. So just to summarize something that I said before, What would be the possibility that the nature of dark matter would impact structure formation? Of course, any given theory that you have here that gives you a particle interaction between the dark matter particles, either supersymmetry or something else, that, for example, would result in self-annihilation, as we have heard, produce some standard model particles, and that would, for example, result in gamma rays that you could look in space. And of course, Alejandro is going to be talking much more about this. But essentially, the cross-section that you expect for this kind of interaction as a function of mass, this is one of the results from the Fermi telescope. This region is excluded. So the kind of cross-sections that you are talking about is, again, weak scale cross-section. So this is 10 to the minus 26 or so centimeter cubes per second. And this is of course, weak scale type of interactions. Also, in direct detection experiments, in this case, you look for the scattering with nuclei. And here again, the scale that you are probing, at least the experiments are probing, is weak scale. So this is a plot that was shown before. This is this neutrino floor. And essentially, again, you are probing these weak scale interactions. So this is just simply to say that these two types of possible dark matter interactions that we hope are there because they would give us a clue about the dark matter nature, they are simply too weak to impact galaxy formation. So I put this in these strange units, centimeters squared per gram. So what I did was in this table to put the limits. I think this was in 2014 for the spin-independent dark matter nucleon interaction, and I just put it roughly around this mass. This is these units of 10 to the minus 23. So I put it in these units because it's going to become important in a second. So this is the kind of cross limits that we have in the cross section for annihilation, and this is for scattering with nuclei. So you see these numbers are very small compared, for example, with nucleon-nucleon elastic scattering, just to have a reference there, so a strong interactions. This, of course, is very is much weaker than that. So in that sense, dark matter is, of course, quite dark. We knew that already, but when you put actually these numbers and you use them, you can compute the mean free path that you would expect in very massive, for example, clusters which have the higher density of dark matter. So there is where the mean free path would be the highest. And even there, the mean free path is just essentially much larger than the size of the system, so it doesn't matter at all. But what about this other possibility? Here in this case, even if you just take it just simply, even without talking about the particle physics theory, just you could imagine that dark matter could collide with itself, again with a given theory behind that in principle, or just for this argument you don't really need to think about which theory is this, but I will mention, I will say something about this a bit later. But essentially, if you have this type of interaction, because you don't have a visible byproduct of the interaction, so this is just a collision between dark matter particles, the constraints become much weaker, just simply because of that. And a way to see this is this famous plot. So this is the so-called bullet cluster. This is a collision between two clusters of galaxies. So you can see here in green is the reconstruction of the weak lensing signal that you see from these two clusters. So you have here one, and here another one. So the weak lensing signal is basically probing the mass. Now, in colors, what you see is the X-ray emission. So that's basically the hot gas component that was in these two clusters. And as they pass by each other, as they collide, of course, the gas collides strongly and produces this. For example, this is a bow shock. And very, you know, it's of course a very collisional, well, it's clearly a collisional system. And this offset between the gas, the hot gas, and the mass distribution is actually a proof of the existence of dark matter. And it's also used to say that dark matter is collisionless, because if it was collisional, it would behave like the gas. But the constraint actually in this lack of collisionality is actually quite weak. So the constraint is around 2 cm² per gram. So if you compare that with the other numbers that I mentioned before, it's much, much, much larger. So it's actually so large that it's of the order of the, well, the strong kind of interactions. So if this possibility is there, it is actually likely, or it may be possible, that dark matter is collisional in a, with an amplitude that is given by the strong force. There are several ways. So this remains one of the strongest constraints. This is one of them. Actually, I'm going to move to this plot. Well, yeah. So this is one of them. You can put them here in this plot. So this is a cross-section per unit mass as a function of a scale. Or, well, I have put here the velocity dispersion, the velocity. You can see here, for example, cluster scales, right? Clusters will have larger scales and also larger typical dark matter velocities. Here you have Milky Way scale and dwarf galaxies, so small galaxies. And what you would have, most of the constraints to date are actually in this kind of range. One of them is the bullet cluster, but you can also get a constraint from the ellipticity of galaxies, because if you have collisions, you could think it as in a gas, right? Collisions tends to create a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So it tends to create, to homogenize the orbits, basically. So it makes the system more spherical. I will describe this more in detail later. And if you look at the you can get observations from the ellipticity of elliptical galaxies, actually, the shape of the potential, and is not so spherical as it would be if dark matter was collisional. And that puts also a constraint. So it has a triaxiality, it has is not spherical. But that constraint is also of this order. So you get those type of constraints, and there are others, there is a diversity of constraints, but all of them are roughly at that scale that I mentioned, 1-2 centimeters squared per gram. And actually below the scale of the Milky Way or so, there is basically nothing. There is no constraint. So in principle, you can have here this region where you have a very high cross-section that is essentially not probed by observations, is free. So in that sense, you have the constraints, the observations actually allow this collisional dark matter to be there. And what I mean by collisional dark matter, I mean, it sounds like it's very strongly collisional, but it's not. One can compute the average scattering rate per particle in the center of a galaxy, say, like our own. And that would just depend on the cross-section and the density of dark matter in the region, and then the typical velocities. And that rate is actually 1 per particle per Hubble time. So, you know, each particle in average will only collide once. So it's not a fluid. It's something that is kind of in between. It's kind of a rarefied gas, for example. So this is, for example, given by this Knudsen number that compares the mean free path to the characteristic length of the system. And that's actually of the order of 1. So when I'm talking about collisional dark matter, just keep this in mind. It's not really collisional in the sense that we understand the gas. It's really in this kind of regime. So because this is allowed, you can construct, there are multiple models that you can construct that can give you this kind of behavior. And one natural one, for example, would be just to think about the analog of Rutherford scattering, right? So there you would have a Coulomb interaction that mediates, you have a new interaction that mediates the collision, and in that case you expect, for example, a velocity dependence, actually quite steep, that goes as the velocity to the power of -4. And you could easily avoid the constraints here and get something that is very, very strong here. Or you can have also a Yukawa, like if your mediator has a mass. So there has been many models constructed to kind of give you this kind of behavior. So they are motivated by particle physics models. So that's one possibility. The second possibility that I want to mention, because it's quite important for galaxy formation, is that, again, you could have a model where dark matter could, making this analogy again of the Coulomb interaction, then you can have something analogous to quantum scattering. So if you have the dark matter belongs to a sector that is hidden, it has its own interactions, it could have its own mediators, so it could interact with these dark photons, for example, and create something analogous to quantum scattering. And if you remember from my lecture yesterday, that would essentially mean that if dark matter is coupled to a relativistic particle, in this case this dark photon, early in the universe, then that creates a similar situation as that between baryons and photons. So it means that when fluctuations try to collapse, try to grow, they feel the pressure of this dark radiation. So you have a suppression. This is the standard. This is the density perturbation as a function of the scale factor or time, and this is the standard CDM growth. So here you don't have this effect, and the perturbation simply grows in time. But in the case of these kind of models, what you have is these oscillations that are the result of this balance between pressure and gravity. And an analogy to the photons and the baryons, then you also have at some point, later when the universe is expanding, of course these photons decouple, these dark photons decouple from dark matter, but as they decouple, they drag along for a time, they drag along the dark matter, and they produce this, what is called collisional damping, or silk damping in photons and baryons. So this is a very well-known mechanism that is seen in the CMB between photons and baryons, and something similar could be possible for dark matter. Later on, once they fully decouple, then again, dark matter, this type of dark matter becomes essentially a CDM, basically. So this type of behavior is actually allowed, again, by observation. Yes?
But the amplitude is going to be different, right?
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
This is something about the size of the large-scale structure you see in N, right?
Yes. So the for example, the scale, the baryonic acoustic oscillation scale is, you know, the sound horizon is 120, 150 megaparsecs. This scale is much smaller. We are talking about maybe tens of kiloparsecs, depending specifically on the model. But it's essentially the same physics, just with different, instead of having the Compton scattering mediating this collisional damping, you have this kind of mechanism, right? So the couplings, the cross sections are going to be different, but the physics is essentially the same. So the bottom line is that I want to say is that, of course, the search for visible byproducts continues and it's very, very, very important. And of course, there is a tremendous effort to try to see them. We know that it's quite dark, dark matter, and that just means that from the point of view of galaxy formation and evolution, all these processes are irrelevant. But this possibility remains that this new dark matter physics that is hidden in a way because it doesn't have necessarily these visible byproducts can actually have an impact, and that just would essentially mean that dark matter is not as inert as is commonly assumed. And in particular, there are two, I think, unsolved questions for galaxy formation that are connected or could be connected to the nature of dark matter. And these are the questions that I think we, I'm very interested in, because I think we are very close to solve them. And if we solve them in a way that we don't find signs of dark, of new dark matter physics, then you essentially, that would essentially establish CDM as the only model within the particle dark matter model as a structure formation model. But of course, if one of these questions turns out to give us a hint of new dark matter physics, that would of course be very relevant. So one of the first questions that I want to mention is this: is the minimum mass scale for galaxy formation set by dark matter nature or by the physics of gas and stars? Of course, we know that this physics is there, so it has to have a role, but does this one has a role as well? As mentioned in my talk yesterday, you start from the CMB, and then there's the onset of structure formation as the gravity drives dark matter to clump together, and then you begin to form these dark matter halos, and the formation of the first dark matter halos depends on the nature of dark matter. Of course, in the case of CDM, the scale of this is so small that it's essentially irrelevant for galaxy formation, because galaxies cannot really form in the smallest halos that you expect to see to form in CDM. They form much larger halos. But in other kind of dark matter models, they might be actually important. Of course, the first galaxies would form, I mean, there is a line here, but they would not necessarily form in these ones. They would form much larger ones. And these are, of course, connected to gas physics. So I mentioned, I showed this plot yesterday, I believe, or one similar. This is the power spectrum, so the amplitude of dark matter clustering as a function of scale. Large scales, K means small scales. So you could think about this, the galactic scale, the cluster scale, and the cosmological scales. Of course, the power spectrum is very well constrained here by a CMB, gravitational lensing, and many other probes, baryon acoustic oscillations, etc., etc. But as you get closer and closer to the galactic scales, the constraints get weaker and weaker. And we really don't know what the clustering of dark matter is here. And here, actually, the dark matter clustering could be like CDM, and you know, have a fall off all the way here. Or it could be something as is known as warm dark matter, which is here. For example, an sterile neutrino, this kind of mass, say. In this case, it's the free streaming of the particles as they are relativistic in the early universe that produces this cutoff here. So that would be the dark matter nature impacting, having an impact on galaxy formation. And this other effect, which I mentioned earlier, is these interactions between dark matter and relativistic particles have these oscillations, produce these dark acoustic oscillations, if you want, which are very similar to these ones, but as I was saying earlier, they occur at smaller scales, and they could also have an impact. So I want to stop in this to give you an example of how this actually done observationally, one of the probes that we have in the power spectrum. And the way this is done, one possibility is to look at what is known as the Lyman alpha forest. So the Lyman alpha forest is essentially probes the intergalactic medium in the universe. And it does it in the following way. So imagine that you have here a quasar. So a quasar is an accretion disk that is in a supermassive black hole. That accretion disk is, of course, very luminous. And one of the emission lines, or one of you will have some emission from the hydrogen that is being excited here in Lyman alpha, essentially. But as this light moves towards us, it encounters gas along the line of sight. And this gas will basically create absorption lines of the light that was emitted here. And these absorption lines would occur at redshifts that are, of course, closer to us, and that means that the absorption line is blue shifted. So this is what is known as the Lyman alpha forest, and it's essentially each of these lines is encoding the gas distribution, the neutral hydrogen distribution along the line of sight. And because it's encoding that information, and we believe that gas should follow dark matter, then it gives us a measure of the power spectrum. And this measure is this a measurement here. So it's, again, the power spectrum as a function of scale at different redshifts. And, you know, this measurement can be used to constrain the power spectrum. So I just wanted to put a parenthesis here just to give you an idea how this is done with observations. Now, another parenthesis. So I want to mention how you actually deal with this possible collisions between dark matter particles in an n-body simulation. So yesterday I talked a lot about n-body simulations, and in that case it was only gravity that mattered. In this case, how do you deal with collisions? So I just want to say a few words about that. So remember, this is really not a fluid, so you cannot go and use the Navier-Stokes equations, for example, right? Because you are not in the fluid regime. And of course, you cannot use the collisionless Boltzmann equation because you have collisions. So you actually have to deal with the collisional Boltzmann equation full. So this is this part here. If this was equal to zero, that's basically CDM. But in this case, you have a collisional term, a collisional operator here, that is related to your particle physics model, so to your cross-section between the dark matter particles. So this is a complicated term, but essentially relates the cross-section, so this is your particle physics, and the rate of scattering particles inside and out of your phase space. So this is a very complicated equation. I mean, the one with zero is already complicated. This is even more complicated. So the way we deal with it is, again, to make first a strong ansatz. In the simulation, you cannot resolve this F, which is the phase space distribution, really the microscopical phase space distribution. What you do is resolve what is called the coarse grain, you know, at much larger scales, which are the scales that you resolve in your simulation. So the answer is that this is the same as evolution as the coarse grain. Then once you make that answer, then you make a probabilistic approach. Again, you discretize your phase space distribution as you do with CDM. And in this case, you introduce the collisions with a Monte Carlo approach. So you compute in regions around each of the particles, you compute the local probability of collisions to happen, and then you choose pairs of particles according to that probability, and you draw basically a random number, and then you say, okay, this particle collided or not. But just to emphasize again, this, when I say particles, I'm always talking about simulation particles, which are many, many orders of magnitude more massive than the real dark matter particles, and also separated at, you know, kiloparsec scales. So this is a big jump from going from the microphysics to the microphysics here. So I close that parenthesis to say, okay, what is the consequence of that in regards to this question, which is, again, are non-gravitational dark matter interactions irrelevant for galaxy evolution? So I mentioned yesterday that one of the predictions of CDM is to say that you are going to form a dark matter halo, and basically all of the halos are going to have a almost near universal distribution of dark matter. So if you take the spherical average of the density from the center of the halo, that has an almost universal behavior, which is this dashed line here. This is very close to the NFW profile that is known. Now, this is the density and the scale radius. If I take the equivalent to what would be the temperature in that halo, which is the velocity dispersion, this is not a thermal system, but you can think about the velocity dispersion of the particles as the ones that are maintaining the system in equilibrium. So this is the velocity dispersion here as a function of radius. And in CDM, you have this bell shape here. And the reason you have this bell shape is basically fixed by the condition that this density profile is in equilibrium. You can see then that this has to be like this to have this equilibrium. Now, what happens when you include collisions? When you include collisions, imagine that you start with a system like this. You switch on collisions, and what is happening is that here, your rate of collisions is going to be the highest because the density is the highest. So your particles start colliding here, and they collide by exchanging energy between them. But because you have this bell shape, when they collide here and they exchange energy with the neighbors here, they gain energy. So they become, in a way, there's kind of a heat flux from this direction to this direction. And that means that the particles expand their orbits, they increase their temperature, if you want, or their velocity, and then they reduce their density. And this is essentially the effect of these collisions. You can, this is actually the result of simulation, but it's easy to understand why this has to be like this. So if dark matter has these strong self-interactions of this order, then you expect dark matter halos not to be NFW, but to have a core. And you expect the velocity dispersion not to have this bell shape, but to have this isothermal, if you want, distribution here. Because again, the collisions tend to create an isothermal distribution, as they would do in a gas, for example. As I said, you can do this in simulations. We did this in 2012. Many people before us did it in the 2001, 2002, when there was a very strong push for self-interacting dark matter. And that's something that has revived, actually, in the last few couple of years. But essentially, all these simulations agree in this. When you create a CDM simulation, you have, this is a Milky Way-sized halo. You have, this is the size of the system, the virial radius. You create, the dark matter is expected to have this triaxial shape because gravity is not... the initial conditions are not perfectly spherically symmetric. You have this triaxiality, you have very high density here, so the color code here is in white, very high density. And then you have this strong abundance of substructures that are within this halo. In self-interacting dark matter, you have something that is spherical, much less dense, as I showed in the previous plot. And in principle, you have also less structures here. And you can achieve all these with this kind of order of magnitude. So it has a very strong effect. As you can see, it has a substantial effect on galaxy formation, because, of course, the galaxy is going to form inside these dark matter halos, and it's going to see a very different dark matter distribution. This is basically saying something similar. So this is the spherical average dark matter distribution. If you compare CDM with this self-interaction, you will have this NFW versus a core. And this, for example, would be significant if these models, if you have also a coupling with the standard model, and you expect to see an indirect detection signal, they will have a different, you have to use a different kind of profile. Now, for direct detection experiments, this will also have an impact, because collisions, as I say, they tend to create a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So maybe you remember yesterday that I mentioned that in the case of CDM, your distribution looks, it has important deviations from a Maxwellian. So the Maxwellian in this case is the dashed line that you see there. And CDM is in black. And it has these features that are connected to the assembly history of the halo. Collisions erase that history. So they erase that history and create something that is very close to a Maxwellian. So if, yes?
Now you can say something about the ghost curve problem, that simulation for reactive
dark matter? Yes, I'm going to arrive into that in, yeah, maybe 5-10 minutes. Thanks. Yeah, I think it's close now. It's getting close. So I was mentioning these two questions of that are unsolved. Maybe there is a scale of galaxy formation that is connected to dark matter nature, and maybe non-gravitational dark matter interactions have an impact on galaxy evolution. And I try to give arguments on how this would change if you introduce models that are different from dark matter, from cold dark matter. Now, I just say that might be a possibility, but are we actually seeing hints of that already in observations? Are the clues of this new dark matter physics, in particular in dwarf galaxies? So a dwarf galaxy looks something like this. This is a Milky Way satellite. Well, it's a satellite of our own galaxy called Fornax. And this is how it looks like. It's this collection of stars that you see there, very diffuse. It has roughly 10 to the 7 solar masses. This is actually a massive, one of the massive satellite galaxies in our Milky Way. And these galaxies, I would say, they are optimal dark matter detectors, dynamical, because they have this very large abundance of dark matter. So the ratio between the dark matter and the normal, ordinary matter can be up to 100 or more. Because dark matter dominates so much the potential, then whatever the baryons are doing there, it has less of an impact on the dark matter distribution that, you know, whatever you can have from your new dark matter physics. So this is why I think they are optimal, and they might have clues of new dark matter physics. So in that case, one can typically do, let me skip this because this is not so important. How much time do I have left? Sorry.
20 minutes,
okay, that's plenty of time. Okay, so what about the clues of this new dark matter physics? So one of them that I want to talk about is just simply the abundance of galaxies. I mentioned yesterday that from n-body simulations such as these, we can get the abundance of structures, so dark matter halos that will be here, 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 and here. One simple thing that you could do to see if the model is correct is just simply count the number of halos that you have and see if that corresponds to the number of galaxies you have. That's the simplest, one of the simplest things one could think of. And when you do that, then you would predict something like this, which is this dashed line here. Now, if you look at the actual galaxies, the actual observations lie something like this. So this is the points here with error bars. Of course, this is clearly different, but we know why this is different, because there is important physics going on here that basically tell you that for each dark matter halo, you don't have a galaxy necessarily. And the reason why you don't have a galaxy necessarily is because galaxy formation is a process that is actually quite inefficient and is affected, for example, by supernovae. So when supernovae explode, they remove substantial amounts of gas from the galaxy. So imagine that you have a galaxy in the early universe is forming, and as the first generation of stars blow up, they basically remove all the gas. If the gravitational potential is not strong enough, they remove all the gas, and you are basically you don't have any more gas to form stars. So that galaxy becomes dead, essentially. So this is what happens here at smaller masses. In a larger masses, you have this effect of active galactic nuclei. So again, this is the effect of the supermassive black holes in very, very massive galaxies. So again, those can produce basically winds that expel the gas from the center of these massive galaxies and again deplete or create this inefficiency of galaxy formation at very large masses. So these two processes are, we know that they are there, they have been of course observed, and we can model them more or less reasonably, although there are some problems. And this model that I'm putting here in green, it's a galaxy formation model that sits on top of this one. It's not an actual simulation, but it's a kind of a semi-analytical way of modeling galaxy formation and basically reproduce very well the observations up to this point here, which is the scale of dwarf galaxies. Another way to see this inefficiency, just to make the point, I think, more striking, is to simply divide the stellar mass, so this is the mass that is inside the galaxy, as a function of the halo mass. The ratio of the stellar mass to the halo mass as a function of the halo mass. This is essentially the same plot as this. I'm just plotting the ratio in the vertical axis, and I'm dividing it by the baryon fraction. So this is the cosmological fraction of baryons in the universe. And what you see by this number in percentage, so what you see is that at the small scale, at the most small masses, you have this stellar feedback. At large masses, you have the AGN feedback. And there is kind of a surprising peak, or well, there is a coincidence, if you want, of the Milky Way being at the scale of the most efficient galaxy formation processes. Well, most efficient at the level of 25% or so. So this is what I meant when saying that galaxy formation is quite inefficient compared to the abundance of baryons that are actually available to create stars. Anyway, so you have this prediction, and as I said, you agree very well in CDM until these scales. But if you want to go to smaller scales, you look in detail into observations, and then you realize that there is a problem. So it's essentially the same thing, but here instead of doing the abundance as a function of a stellar mass, I'm doing the abundance as a function of global rotation. So this is essentially the it's a proxy for the maximum rotational velocity that if you could put a trace particle in your halo, a tracer particle in your halo, it would be the maximum circular velocity that I could acquire given the potential of the halo. And this can actually be more or less, you can actually measure more or less this. And again, this is the same scale, this dwarf scale, it's the same line here and here. And above this line, the predictions agree very well, but below, the observations are here, and CDM is somewhere here. So this is a problem that is still unsolved. We don't know why, we don't know how to solve this correctly with CDM. So in the last part of this lecture, I will just mention these two other problems, and then I think we can stop, and then I continue later on. So one, as I said, is related to the abundance, and the other one is related to the structure of dark matter inside these halos. You take, again, one of these simulations, the Milky Way, for example, would be like here, and then you have all these substructures, and each of these substructures will carry a satellite. So this is actual representation of the Milky Way satellite. So say this subhalo would correspond to a satellite like this. So you can ask the question, okay, in these satellites that I see here, what is the dark matter distribution that is inside of them. And this is this plot shown here. This is the circular velocity, or you can, it's essentially just the enclosed mass. So you take your satellite, say this, you take this substructure, and then you just, from the center of that substructure, you go, as a function of radius, you take the enclosed mass, essentially. That tells you something about the dark matter distribution. It's similar to taking the density profile. It's just that this one is more is observed more directly. You can do that for the satellites, again, as a function of radius, and it turns out, because the satellites, the observation that you get from the satellite is limited, you only see the projection in the sky, so you only see two dimensions, the two spatial dimensions, and you only see one velocity, which is the velocity along the line of sight. So you have only three dimensions, but to reconstruct the potential, you know that you need the six-dimensional phase space. So because you have this restriction, it turns out that for a system like a dwarf galaxy, you cannot really construct this curve all the way. You can only construct it in a specific point. I can tell you more in detail why this point, if you are interested. But the bottom line is that you can measure this accurately only at one point. You do this exercise for 10 satellites. In this case, these are the classical satellites. Here is a sculpture, Fornax, Ursa Minor, and then you can put these points here. Now you go to your simulations, and in the simulation, of course, you can measure anything you want. And in the simulations, you can take your substructures, and then you start measuring this enclosed mass, and the most massive lay more or less in this band here, and then you go to a smaller one, and it starts going here and here and so on. And what has become very apparent is that the most massive subhalos in the simulations have an excess of dark matter compared to what is inferred from these satellites. So in other words, the CDM seems to predict a surplus of dark matter in the center of satellites. That is very hard to explain as well, just within the context of CDM. And now we finally come to the Korkos problem. So this is a very controversial issue in CDM when it comes to dwarf galaxies. And this is the last point I'm going to make before the coffee break. It is controversial because, as I mentioned earlier, you can only do this really reliably in one point. And if you want to measure if you have an NFW or a core, it's like measuring the slope in a function. You need at least 2 points to get the slope. Otherwise, you cannot get the slope here, obviously. And this is really the reason why it's so hard to say if dwarf galaxies. Yes?
Yeah. What makes that point special?
What is special about it is that these systems that are here are the most massive subhalos that you have in your host halo. And because they are the most massive, you would expect them to be the places of where galaxies form, where satellites form. At least they should form here, even if they don't form in the least massive ones. If they form here, they would need to form with this kind of potential. Yes. Yes. So the reason is that there is a degeneracy, and I can explain this quickly here. The reason is this: to measure the potential in a galaxy like this, what you have to do is solve basically the Jeans equation. That's what is typically done, and that's just a balance between the gravity. Here you have your potential, which is dominated by dark matter, so you don't have to care about the potential of the stars. So this is the one you want to know. And in this side, you basically have the pressure, if you want the pressure terms that comes from the velocity dispersion, and your density of stars. So these are your tracers. This is the three-dimensional distribution of the stars, and this is the radial velocity dispersion. But you also have the anisotropy. So the anisotropy measures, all the stars are not going to have only radial orbits, they could have tangential orbits. So the anisotropy measures the degree of, if you want, the deviations from circular orbits or radial orbits. So you have beta, you have sigma, and you have rho, and you only observe either sigma and rho, and that's in projection. You don't observe beta. So you have a degeneracy between beta, the anisotropy parameter, and the potential that you have here. Now, when you make it turns out that the velocity dispersion of these systems is such that this degeneracy is broken in a point. So you can show this if the dispersion is flat towards larger radii, you can actually show from this equation that you are going to have a point where your degeneracy is going to be broken or diminished. So that point, basically all your dark matter distribution have to have passed through that point. And this is why I mean that here you can only really measure one point. And that is another way of saying that the errors are minimized in that point. I should probably wrap up, so just let me wrap up with this. Now, that's why it's very hard to make a convincing argument that there are cores or that there is NFW in this kind of system. This is really the key reason. Now, of course, there are possible ways out of this. And one possibility that caused a lot of attention is, well, you can separate the stars in your dwarf in two populations. One population that is close to the center and another one that is far away. If those two populations have in general, they have very different distributions. They are obviously one is in the center and one is outside, but also the kind of velocity distributions they have, the metallicities that they have, etc., etc. So it's a little bit more complicated than that, but it turns out that these authors here claim that you can play this game that I mentioned before with the Jeans equation in two points. So you can trace the stars in that system separately, and then you can put a point here in the center and a point outside. And as I said, if you have two points, then you can have a slope. So you can constrain the slope. And when they do that, they see a strong evidence for sculpture and Fornax. Here's Fornax, here's a sculpture. Here you can actually do it with three, that these systems are cored. But there are many assumptions when you do this, several assumptions. Some are strong, some are weak. So different people have come up with ways to say, wait a minute, if you take certain models, if you break some of these assumptions, then this is no longer the case, and you can accommodate an NFW. So this is why I just say that of these three problems that I mentioned, the abundance, the too big to fail problem, and the core cost problem, this is the one that is more controversial. And I think I leave it there, and I continue, I think, after the coffee break. Thank you.
Okay, questions?
Jesus, when you say that if some of these problems could be addressed by other kind of non-gravitational physics, what are you exactly referring to? Just the gas or some details of the particles' interactions?
So I'm gonna be talking about that, okay. But it's essentially both. So I'm going to talk about both. You can solve it with new dark matter physics, and I would say there are paths towards a solution with baryonic physics, gas physics.
Okay. More questions? So I have one that I got a little bit missed. In the simulations for the where you had collisional dark matter, so there it's just elastic scattering that you're assuming, and you're using constraints from direct detection there? No. Right? Because
it's
the sizes of
yeah, because so from direct detection, of course, you cannot this is really hidden, right? So the elastic scattering between the dark matter particles, so they don't necessarily collide with nuclei. They could.
Yep.
There could be a mixing, you know, to collide with nuclei, but in these models, they you don't need them. You don't need that mixing.
Okay, but you can put then constraints on that after the simulation.
Yes, yes. I mean, if you, so all the simulation is telling you is this. If you have a particle physics model that has these interactions, dark matter collisions, and on top of that has some mixing with the standard model, then your assumptions for indirect detection and direct detection have to be changed, have to be modified, because the structure of dark matter halos is not CDM, it's different. So if you can construct those models, which people have constructed them, then you have to use the predictions from these new simulations and not from CDM.
More questions? If not, then let's thank Jesus again. Okay, before you take your coffee, please let's meet outside of the auditorium for the picture, and then we'll give the coffee break, 25 minutes.